Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace that's made available for every one of us so we can be justified. We're praying, O Lord, that that justification by faith will be the experience of every one of us in Jesus' name. And we're praying that you'll so live within us that the transformation of life that belongs to those who are truly born again will be ours in Jesus' name. Grant us understanding in the study of the word tonight, so that we'll be stronger in the Lord, and we'll live the life that will bring glory unto you. In Jesus' name we pray. In our series of Bible study, we're now in James chapter 2. Today we're looking at chapter 2 verse 14 through to the end. And this is talking about faith and the corresponding action, the attending fruit that follows faith. Reading from verse 14. What does it profit, my brethren, though a man say he has faith and have not works? Can faith save him? He continues then in verse 17. Even so faith, if it has not works, is dead, being alone. He continues with that emphasis in verse 20. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? And to the very end of the chapter, the same emphasis is maintained. For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. The passage we're looking at today has been neglected and misunderstood by many preachers and teachers of the world. The reason is because they think that James is opposed to the doctrine of justification by faith. Because if you study the epistle of Paul to the Romans, and also the epistle of Paul to the Galatians in particular, you will see the emphasis there of justification by faith without the deeds of the law. And coming with that understanding to the epistle of James, there are teachers and interpreters that seem not to understand that this section of the scripture is equally inspired of God as those epistles of Paul are. They count James and Paul as expressing opposite views or contrary doctrines. In fact, they insist that Paul emphasized being saved by faith without works, while James, to their own understanding, is emphasizing faith without works that will not bring salvation to anyone. But as you look carefully and you study with proper understanding, you will see that actually Paul and James have wonderful agreement and balance in the study and the teaching of the Word of God. They show the two sides of the same coin. Actually, what Paul the Apostle was teaching is that works before salvation are worthless. They do not have any value. That if anybody thinks he's going to be saved by his works without coming to Christ first, that will be useless. So then he emphasized faith. He says, forget about what you have done. Forget about what you can do. Look at Christ who died for you on the cross of Calvary. And on that alone will be the basis and the ground of salvation. And so he emphasizes it's faith without works that brings justification or salvation or redemption and makes you a child of God. But then you understand what James is saying. James says faith cannot stand alone. He's not talking about works after salvation. He's saying it's true you are born again. It's true you are a child of God by faith in Christ. That's how you become a brother. That's how you become a sister. But then, after having that salvation, you now need to bring forth the fruit meet for repentance. It says, if the works after salvation, the works that should be the fruit and the product of faith. If it is not there, then it is evident you don't really have genuine, living, saving faith. Actually, you see then, they are emphasizing the same thing. Because Paul, the apostle himself, emphasized the necessity of good works after salvation. Look at Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works, which God has ordained before, that we should walk in them. Paul is emphasizing the same thing that James was emphasizing. He was saying, after you are born again by faith in Christ, you must produce the fruit. There must be good works. He says, in fact, we are created unto good works. He tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, is a new creature. It's not talking of what happens after you are born again. Before you are born again, no works. All the works we add before we are born again will be self-righteousness. And that cannot save. And so you come just as I am, without any other plea. I come unto thee. Without works, without any good deeds, without any self-righteousness, empty-handed, I come. I come with faith. But now that you step into the kingdom of God, with that faith, the faith will produce something in you. All things are passed away, and behold, all things are become new. In Titus chapter 3, Titus chapter 3, verse 8, it says, this is a faithful saying, and these things I will that thou affirm constantly, that they which have believed in Christ might be careful to maintain good works. They which have believed after salvation, after we manifest faith in the Lord, Paul the apostle is emphasizing, like James is also emphasizing, that there must be good works, that those who have believed will maintain good works. So then you understand, before you come to the Lord, you come just as you are. There's nothing that will bring in your hand. Simply to the cross you cling, and you believe on the Lord, faith, then you get born again. After that faith, then you have the fruit that normally follows salvation. There are 3 points we're going to look at as we consider James chapter 2 today. Number one, faith without fruit is dead. And that you'll find, look at that again, verse 17, even so faith, if it has not works, is dead, being alone. Verse 20, but wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Then in verse 26, for as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. Faith without fruit is dead. Number two, fruit without faith is deceptive. That's how the Pharisees were deceived. They thought they had some outward kind of righteousness without believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. And they came before the Lord, they said they were good enough. I'm not an extortioner like other people. I give tithes of all I possess. I do some good works. And because of their praying and fasting and almsgiving and good deeds, they felt fruit without faith will be able to make it, but that is deceptive. You know what God is looking for? You know what he demands? Faith with fruit. And that's number three. Faith with fruits is demanded. We go to number one. Faith without fruit is dead. We read from verse 14 to verse 20. What does it profit, my brethren? Stop there for a moment. You will discover here that James is not talking to sinners, really. Paul the apostle was talking to sinners. And he said, come, don't wait until you become better. Don't wait for any good works before you come. Faith alone will give you forgiveness, will give you peace of mind, will give you salvation. Come just as you are. Christ has done everything on the cross of Calvary. But then, after you have come, you become a brother, a child of God. And that is the point at which James begins. Go back to chapter 1 verse 2 my brethren. Do you see there? He already knows that you have come, and you came by faith. He is now saying that kind of faith must produce transformation. It must have some fruit. He assumes that already you are born again. Verse 16, do not err, my beloved brethren. You see that? It's talking to the people that are born again already. In chapter 2, verse 1, my brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. You are born again already. You are now in the kingdom. He wants to tell you there must be fruit that will follow your faith. Chapter 2 verse 5. Hearken, my beloved brethren. Now verse 14. What does it profit, my brethren? So then, Paul and James are not really talking about the same person. James was talking about the believers. They are born again already. There must be the evidence of that faith in their lives. Paul the apostle was talking to sinners outside. He says the door is open. Christ has died for you. Come in without any good works. Now that you are inside, you are in the hand of James. And he says, you are born again. Praise the Lord. You manifest faith. Praise the Lord. That faith must produce some fruit. Verse 14 now. What does it profit, my brethren? Though a man say he has faith and have not works, can faith save him? He's saying, can that kind of faith save him eventually, save him finally, in the day of judgment, when God will reward every man according to his works? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you, brethren, one of you children of God, one of you professing to be born again, say unto him, depart in peace, and be warmed, and be filled, notwithstanding, ye give them not those things which are needful to the body. What does it profit? Even so, faith, if it has not work, faith, if it doesn't produce corresponding action, faith, if it doesn't have good deeds, faith, if it doesn't have the fruit meet for repentance, is dead, being alone. Yea, a man may say, he has faith, I have works, show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show you my faith by my works. Thou believest there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. He was telling them, profession is not enough. Empty profession is not enough. You must move ahead to possession. If you say you profess faith, you say you profess salvation in Christ, that salvation in Christ must bear fruit. If it is only intellectual faith, mental assent, I believe in God. Of course, the devils also, they believe there is God. And their own belief is not an empty kind of belief. They even tremble. Or you believe that Jesus is Christ. Of course, even the demons believe that Jesus is Christ. Don't you remember Matthew chapter 8 verse 29? How those devils, they said, we know who you are. Have you come to torment us before the time? They know the time of their torment. They believe and they tremble. That's why he now concludes in verse 20. But wilt thou know? O vain man, he's saying, empty talker. The one that is making empty profession, that faith without works is dead. Actually, that's exactly the same thing that Jesus Christ himself had emphasized when he preached that sermon on the mount in Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7 verse 21. Not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. Not everyone that makes an empty profession, without possession, without practice, without character, without good fruit, will enter into the kingdom of heaven. But he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. It's not the people that say, it's the people that do. That's exactly what James is saying. Be ye doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. In fact, Jesus said, many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name I've cast out devils, and in thy name I've done many wonderful works. Then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. That's empty faith. faith. I never knew you. You were not even born again. It was ordinary profession without possession. It was an empty faith that didn't have good deeds. It was something that didn't produce good works. I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. And for the people that think that Paul was opposed to what James was saying, look at Titus chapter 1, verse 16. They profess that they know God. They profess that they believe in God. They profess that they too, their brethren, they profess that they have been saved by faith. But look at this, but in works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient and unto every good work reprobate. They are strangers to righteousness. They are strangers to holiness. And therefore their profession amounts to nothing. In fact, they might say, Lord, Lord, and they might say they believe in the Lord. And then the Lord is wondering, if you so believe as you are professing to be, how is it that you are disobedient and rebellious and reprobate? In Luke chapter 6, verse 46. Luke chapter 6, verse 46. And why call ye me Lord, Lord? I believe that Jesus is Lord. That's not enough. I believe that Jesus is Savior. That's not enough. Why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? He's saying, add practice to that profession. Add fruit to that faith. And let something show that you are a real child of God. Because, you know, if it is only faith and it doesn't have corresponding action, that thing makes you like nothing. It makes you like a sounding brass. It makes you like tinkling cymbal. It makes you like a person that is just saying, I believe, but it is empty faith. In fact, what James is saying is that your faith, if it is empty like that, it is not up to the faith of demons, because the demons, they even tremble. The demons even, they are afraid. The demons are even saying, we know there is hell, and we know there is a day of torment, but the time has not come. Have you come to torment us before that time? He said, go beyond the faith that is mental. Go beyond the faith even of the demons, and now put some action, some character, some conduct, some profession, some possession to your faith. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 verse 2. Though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could move mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. It says, if there is no love, love your neighbor as yourself. Do unto others as you want them to do unto you. Do some practical things that will show that you have Christ in you. If you have all the faith you can profess, and you do not have those good works, corresponding action, Christian behavior, Christ-like living, it means then you are not a real child of God. In fact, at the time of Jesus Christ, there were some people that professed that kind of faith, but there was no fruit. There was no life to correspond with that kind of faith. And Jesus didn't have any trust, any confidence in them. Look at John chapter 2. John chapter 2, verse 23. Now, when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover, in the feast day, many believed in his name. When they saw the miracles which he did, that's where many people will stop, and they will say, praise the Lord, many believe. Praise the Lord, many raised up their hands. Praise the Lord, many people have surrendered their lives to the Lord. And they actually said they believe that this is the Christ. They believe that he's the Son of God. When they saw the miracles, but Jesus did not have any confidence in that kind of faith, because he didn't produce any fruit. Look at verse 24. But Jesus did not commit himself unto them. Why? Because he knew all men. He knew their character. He knew their conduct. He knew their lifestyle. He knew there was no change. He knew there was no transformation. He knew it was just an empty faith and there was no fruit. Because of that, he will not commit himself unto them. He didn't rely on them. They were not trustworthy. Their character did not reflect that they had any relationship with Christ. In verse 25, and needed not that any should testify of man, for he knew what was in man. That's why he told those people in John chapter 8, verse 30 and 31. As he spake these words, many believed on him. But he wanted them to know that's not enough.
because it can still be empty faith, empty profession. That's why he said in verse 31, then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if ye continue in my word, the word of repentance, if ye continue in my word, the word of restitution, you bring your gift to the altar, you remember that your brother has sought against you, you go back and reconcile with your brother, if you continue in my word, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. That's my word. If you continue in my word, that your righteousness should exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees. If you continue in my word, blessed are the pure in heart, because they shall see God. If you continue in my word, do unto others as you want them to do unto you. If you continue in my word, and you're obedient to the word, and you show some fruit for your faith. And it is not just that faith is standing in isolation, standing alone. There is something you can show as an evidence of that faith. If you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. What the Lord was telling them, and what Paul was telling them, and what James was emphasizing here, is that the faith must bear fruit. Again, let us understand, it is faith and fruit. Not just fruit alone. That leads us now to point number two. Fruit without faith is deceptive. And I want to remind you, this was the condition of the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the religious people of that time. They were running about saying, well, I'm behaving well. My life is all right, but they had never met Christ. They had never believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. They had not gone to Calvary so that their sins would be washed away. What if you even live like an angel today? But before you came to live like an angel, you had some sins. You owe some debt. I mean spiritual debt. And then you were not living right. That is still there. The pollution of the past, the uncleanness of the past, the iniquity of the past, that has not been taken away. It is on record in the books that are written, because the books will be opened on the final day. You have been doing some bad things, and the Lord had been writing them down. All of a sudden, you turned over a new leaf, but you didn't believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You changed yourself. You transformed yourself. I steal no more. I commit adultery no more. I do evil no more. That's all right. But the ones you have done in the past, they have not been cleansed. You must come under the blood of Jesus before those sins will be cleansed away. So that is the terrible thing happening to the people that say, well, I'm living a good life now. I don't smoke anymore. I don't drink anymore. The things I used to do, I don't do them anymore. The ones you did in the past, you need to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ so that they'll be taken away. James chapter 2 verse 18. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, I have works. You see what James is saying here? There are people that are saying there are two things. You take one, I take one. You have faith, that's good for you. I have works, that's good for me. James says both of those people will be condemned. The one that says, I have faith but no fruit, he will not make it. The one that says, I have fruit but no faith, he will not make it. We need the two so that we'll be able to make it. Let me remind you once again of the people, these people that are saying, we have a fruit, but they do not have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. They have not believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. They say that's not necessary. They say that we are moralists. They say we have good works. They say we have good character. They say already our life recommends us to God. Look at it in 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 5. 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 5, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. They have a form of godliness outwardly in character. They talk like Christians. They dress like Christians. They do everything like Christians. They give alms like Christians. Outwardly, they may appear to be Christian, but inwardly, they have not put their faith on the Lord Jesus Christ. And without faith, that will not go far. It will not save your soul. It will not rescue you from hell. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 3, though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor. There are some philanthropic people. There are some hospitable people. There are some people that are just generous and they can give out things. They have not believed on the Lord. That thing is not enough. You will not give more than the Pharisees have given. And all they gave and all they did without faith in the Lord Jesus Christ did not save them. Though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burnt, and have not love, charity. That's the love coming from the very heart of God to the heart of man at the moment of believing, when the love of God is shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Ghost. Until you come to that point where you believe on the Lord, all those good works, they profit you nothing. I told you that that's what the Pharisees were rejoicing about in Matthew chapter 23. You know, they were saying they were very clean, they were alright, they were giving tithes of all that they possessed. Everything was okay for them. They were fasting, they were praying, they were giving alms to the poor. And in fact, they would say they were not extortioners, they are not like this publican. And they were still condemned, because the fruit without faith is deceptive, it is not enough. In Matthew chapter 23, Matthew 23 verse 23, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye pay tithes of mint and anise and cumin, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. They were paying tithe, but there was no faith. They didn't believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. They didn't accept that Jesus was that Messiah, the one that comes as a lamp of God to take away the sins of the world. They didn't have faith in the Lord. They had not forsaken all their self-righteousness to trust in Christ as the Savior, as their sin bearer, as the one that will take them away, as the one that will take them away from their sin and become their substitute. Because they had not done that, Jesus said, with all the tithes they are paying, woe unto you. How many people are relying on that today? And the only thing they can say is that they go to church, they pay their dues in the church, they even work in their denomination, and they read the Bible, and they give money to the beggars, and they try to do the best they can, and their good works are more than their bad evil deeds. But it says, woe unto you, you must come to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 25, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye make clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess. You know, there are people that will come to the church and they try to copy the dressing of the Christian, and they try to copy the language of the Christian, and they try to join the house fellowship, but they have not believed on the Lord. Their hearts have not been cleansed. They have not looked at Calvary. They have not come to Him who alone can bring cleansing and forgiveness and salvation and peace of mind. They feel that the deeds of the Lord, the works of the Lord, the things they are doing, they think that will be sufficient to be able to qualify them for heaven. Verse 26, thou blind Pharisee, cleanse first that which is within the cup and the platter, that the outside of them may be clean also. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye are like the whited sepulchre. Clean outside, white outside, beautiful outside, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness. Even so, ye also outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within are full of hypocrisy and iniquity. You know the problem? There was fruit, a kind of fruit, but there was no faith. I know what the Lord is telling us in Matthew chapter 5 verse 20. Matthew chapter 5 verse 20. It tells us, for I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees. Go beyond the Pharisees and go beyond the scribes. Go beyond the people that just have those good deeds and good works and almsgiving and helping this one and helping that one and being religious and just going to church. I've been confirmed. I take the Lord's Supper. That's not enough. Except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of God. It's simply telling us something. No matter how you try, no matter what kind of good works you are trying to produce, without salvation in Christ, without faith in Christ, it will not be enough to take you to heaven. Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2 verse 16. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law. No, not indeed. He cannot be justified, and you cannot be justified by just the outward form of religious or religiosity or righteousness. But by the faith of Jesus, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ. Not by the works of the law, for by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. No flesh in any denomination, in any church, that thing alone cannot save. In Galatians chapter 3 from verse 10, for as many as are the works of the law are under the curse, for it is written, cursed be is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them, and that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God. It is evident, for the just shall live by faith. You come to eternal life, life in Christ, and the life of God, when you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, the just shall live by faith. That's the beginning point of Christian faith and Christian life. It's not the deeds of the law. Those things cannot save you standing alone, remaining alone. Titus chapter 3, verses 4 and 5. Titus chapter 3, verse 4. But after that the kindness and the love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by the works of righteousness which we have done, no, it cannot be, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost. Once again, it's reminding us that we need faith in Christ. What shall I do to be saved? You remember the Philippian jailer, after he saw that the prison doors were open, and he thought that the prisoners had escaped, and he took it, he saw, he wanted to kill himself. And then Paul cried out and said, do yourself no harm, for we are all here. And then he took the light and he came out looking at them. Then he knew that something supernatural had taken place. Sirs, what shall I do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thine house. That's it. You come just as you are. You believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You believe the gospel. You cannot save yourself. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But Jesus Christ went to the cross to take your punishment and to take your sin upon him. And whosoever will believe on the Lord Jesus Christ now today shall be saved. Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2 from verse 8. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. But then I need to remind you, after you have been born again, after you have been regenerated by that faith in Christ, verse 10 tells you that something will follow. Your life will change. There will be a transformation. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works which God has before ordained that we shall walk in them. He has said there is a way in which we should walk. There is a kind of life we should live after we actually come to the Lord. Faith first, and then the fruit will follow. That leads us to point number three now. Faith with fruit is demanded. Not either this or this, but both this and this. It's not that I have faith, I don't have fruit. No, that's dead. It's not I have fruit, I don't have faith. That's deceptive. You know what God demands? you have faith, and then the fruit must be evident. We now come back to James chapter 2 from verse 21. James chapter 2 verse 21. Was not Abraham our father justified by works? Now you understand what he's talking about. He's talking about Abraham our father. And he's using the word our. He's talking about the family of God. Because, you know, when you talk about Abraham, there are two ways in which Abraham was spoken about in the Bible. One, he was talking about the father of the Jews. That is the father of all the Jewish people. That's natural. But then in a spiritual way, is the father of all the people that believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Galatians chapter 3. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 29, and if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise. It says, if you have come to Christ, if you have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, you are a child of God. You know what? Abraham is not spiritually your father. He now tells us, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? You know the problem that people have, those who misinterpreted the New Testament, they say, there you are now. Because the Bible says Abraham was justified, he was saved by believing on the Lord. He believed on the Lord and it was counted unto him for righteousness. That's the initial experience. He believed on the Lord, and that quotation is in Genesis chapter 15 verse 6. But we're now talking about after he had believed, after he had become a child of God. In fact, after he had become a friend of God, he now had obedience to the Lord. James is talking to the brethren. James is talking to members of the family of God. James is talking to the people that are taking the initial step. Initially, the moment you came to the Lord, you are saved by faith without works. But now you are come, you are a child of God, you are a member of the body of Christ, and now you are regarding you as that child of God. Obedience must, you must show obedience for your faith. In verse 22, seest thou how faith wrought with his works? And by works was faith made perfect. You know what he's saying? He's saying your work, your attitude, your life, your behavior is what makes faith visible. I cannot see the wind. I can only know the wind is there by the action of the wind. I cannot see the radio waves. I can only know that the radio waves are there by the action of the radio waves. I cannot see electricity. I can only know that that electricity is there by the action, by the effect that that electricity produces. I cannot see your faith. I can only know that your faith is there by the work of obedience, by the life of righteousness, by the gentleness, the kindness, the honesty, the life of Christ in you. The faith is invisible, but it is the effect, it is a product, it is a work of that faith that makes the faith visible. So he says, do you see now that your faith is made perfect by the word, made visible by the work? And it is the thing that makes us to know the reality of that faith. He goes on in verse 23, as the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed to him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. He goes to the beginning. Yes, we know how it started. He believed on the Lord originally, initially, and that righteousness was imputed unto him. But there's another word. Not only imputation, but there is impartation. It was imparted unto him as well. And from the life of obedience now to the Lord, we can see that that thing has been imparted unto him. And then we can see the faith that was invisible before is now visible for everyone to see. Look at verse 24. You see then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith only. He's saying isolated faith, empty faith, the faith that doesn't produce any work, The faith that doesn't produce any good behavior, that saves nobody. He goes on with another illustration. Likewise also was not Rahab the harlot justified by works when he had received the messengers and sent them out another way? You know what he's saying? He said Rahab did not have empty faith, did not have shallow faith. She said, I believe that the Lord has given you the land. I believe. And everybody is trembling because of you. That's why he hid them. That's why he threw his apart along with the children of Israel. That's why he said, are you not going to make a promise to me that when you come, you will save me alive and you will save my family alive as well? That is faith that expresses itself in something very concrete because he really believed the Lord. And then the conclusion, for as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. The Lord wants us to have the two. He wants us to have faith. He wants us to have the fruit that will follow. In 1 Timothy chapter 1. 1 Timothy chapter 1. Reading from verse 5. 1 Timothy 1, 5. Now the end of the commandment is charity out of a pure heart and of a good conscience and faith unfeigned. Faith unpretended. It's something that is not hypocritical. Something that is real. Something that is solid. And something that can produce effect and fruit and good works. In Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5 verse 6. Galatians 5, 6. For in Jesus Christ, neither circumcision availeth anything, nor circumcision, but faith which worketh by love. Faith produces something. And you know, those are the writings of Paul the Apostle. He's telling us that faith will produce. If the faith does not produce, that faith is empty, that faith is dead, and that kind of faith will not take us to heaven. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 3. Remembering without ceasing your work of faith. You see here, faith is producing something. That's what the Lord is telling us, that our faith should actually produce. Titus chapter 3. Titus chapter 3 verse 14. And let ours also learn to maintain good works for necessary uses, that they be not unfruitful. Let those who say they belong to our assembly, the people that say they belong to the family of God, the people that claim to have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, let ours also learn to maintain good works. They shouldn't be running about like those who are saying that they have faith, there is no good fruit, there is nothing at all. In fact, as you look at the whole of Hebrews chapter 11, do you realize that those heroes of faith, how do we see their faith? By the things that their faith produced. They believed God, so they did this. They believed God, so they obeyed God. They believed God, so they built an ark. They believed God, so they did what the Lord told them to do. That's always the action of faith. If you believe the Lord, you are really going to produce the work of faith. In 2 Timothy, look at this. 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 19. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. The implication is, many, many people may say, I belong to the Lord. I belong to the Lord. The Lord knows those who really belong to him. How are we going to know that you belong to the Lord? Let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. That's the bottom line. That's the evidence. That's the fruit. If you really belong to the Lord, you are going to show something for it. Let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Fruit must accompany faith. For faith to be real, for faith to be acceptable, and for that thing to be genuine. As we look at the scriptures, it says, examine yourself. And you need to examine yourself. find out, do you really have genuine faith? Find out, can you match your practice with your profession? Find out, does your faith have evidence? Is it alive? Is it active? Or is it dead? Does the Spirit of God bear witness with your spirit that you have living faith, vital faith, dynamic faith, saving faith, and that faith is producing fruit? Does your character of good works actually show to the people around you that your faith is genuine and it is not fake? Can your neighbors testify that you are living such a life that convinces them you have real faith, living faith, and that you are born again? What do you have? Is it only faith without fruit? Or is it fruit without faith? Or has God so blessed you and has God so saved you that now by the grace of God you have faith and you have the fruit to show for it as well? It's time to find out. If you wait until the final day, you may discover on the final day what you are carrying about was empty faith, and then you are lost forever without a chance to come back to the Lord. Or maybe what you are carrying about is fruit without faith, and then you are being deceived, and then you go to hell, and you will not blame anybody for it. But today, you can call upon the Lord and say, Lord, I don't want my faith to be empty. I don't want an empty faith, empty profession, dead faith. I want faith that is alive. Faith in the Lord Jesus Christ that gives me the life of Christ and will produce good fruit in my life. I want you to call upon the Lord. Rise up, please. This is more important. This is more important. Call upon the Lord so that that evidence, that fruit, the good works will be in your life. You will not have the faith of the devil. You will not have the faith of demons. You'll not have only the faith that is trembling or the faith that is empty. There'll be good works, good works. You'll be a new creature. All things pass away, all things becoming new. Talk to the Lord in prayer. Are you really born again? If you are born again, where is the evidence? Where is the evidence? Are you a child of God? Where is the evidence? Is your name in the book of life? Where is the evidence? New life, eternal life, Christ-like life, a pure life, a different language, a person that doesn't dress like the world, doesn't drink what the world is drinking, a person that has a total change. Make sure that faith is real and genuine and alive and saving before you leave here today.